Mark Rogers TV and Last Word on Sports, talking Florida football. So the Gators have captured the Eastern Division Championship, the final step a bit ugly, disposing of Vandy 9-7. We bring in David Waters from Gator Sports Radio to help us. David, I'm going to say the defense is a given. The Gators gave us another effort on defense, even though it was Vandy, that we expect. Let's settle in on this offense and see if we can make something of it. It was not pretty. Treon Harris, 12 of 24 for .158, 275 total yards, only 57 in the second half. So let's take it from there in regards to what you see out of the Florida offense, understanding that Vandy's getting much better on defense.
Yeah, like you said, yeah, that Vandy defense is good, but it seems like Florida just couldn't recover from, you know, the great field position they had early in the game and just could never find a way to put it in the end zone. Whether it was, you know, have a good play and then follow it up with a bad play, or, of course, the turnovers. You know, Florida had four total on the game. And it's kind of seemed, you know, the very first drive, they had a great kickoff return. And then Treon Harris finds Brandon Powell for what looked like a touchdown. They would, referees reviewed it. Never could really see the ball still hit the ground, but it was bobbled. Still never really saw the ball hit the ground, but they did rule incomplete. And so, yeah, Florida, you know, didn't score there. So, but did they score a touchdown later on? And then I think what we did find out, you know, Michael Wayne, a couple of weeks ago, we kind of saw it, but he's starting to influx some of the defensive linemen as guys who can be a lead blocker. So we saw on Kelvin Taylor's touchdown, Brian Cox was in at fullback. Both guys went left. Brian Cox had a huge block. Kelvin Taylor scores the only touchdown of the game for Florida. So, but that was followed up with a missed extra point. So that was where the 6 points come from. Florida was in a little bit of a hole after Ralph Webb for Vanderbilt scampered for about 75 yards. Florida was down 7-6 most of the time. But like you said, it kind of goes back to Treon Harris. But that offensive line, you know, we kind of knew going in last week, Michael Wayne's press conference last Monday, he said Martez Ivey and David Sharp were going to be limited if they played at all. Florida did get in some trouble on the offensive line, and they had to insert Sharp and let him play anyway, even though he was injured. So it didn't really help. You could definitely tell he was injured. That offensive line struggled all day against Vanderbilt. Vanderbilt brought an extra rusher probably almost every time, and especially up the middle. So Treon really couldn't, you know, find his way through the middle. And, you know, we thought the weakness for Treon was hitting his passes over the, you know, standing in the pocket and try to hit his passes. But every one of his completions were from the pocket. When he rolled out was when he really struggled. And that's kind of been a change for Treon. So it kind of seems like he may be getting – used to McElwain style of offense instead of McElwain trying to, you know, get Treon. But we haven't seen a lot of runs from Treon, design runs, and I think that's a lot to do with there's no depth. So, you know, behind him, if he does get hurt, there's no one behind him. So I don't think that the offense is designed for Treon's best attributes right now. But like I said, you know, the bootleg passes that Treon used had kind of been figured out. Teams are starting to spy him a little bit, and Vanderbilt did a really good job of that. And the running game has really struggled, and Scarlett had a 20-yard run, his first run of the game. But then Kelvin Taylor and Sharp, the guys, I don't think they're running the ball enough. So I think McElwain, they need to go back to the drawing board, and maybe in the offensive line struggled run blocking again. So it would just be nice to see, you know, Kelvin Taylor and Scarlett get more runs to help Treon out a little bit more.
And with the way Vanderbilt was trying to hold the ball, obviously not that successful on offense most of the day, but they did slow it down. Florida just didn't run that many plays, if you really look at it. Neither team did. It was one of those type of football games. It's a team that has thrived on ball security the entire season at plus 13 coming in. They go -4 with a 1 Treon pick, plus the 3 fumbles lost. So obviously that prevented sustaining drives as well.
Right, and the interception Treon threw really wasn't a bad interception. It was a fourth down, and it was a chuck-up play. You know, it was actually better than the punt. It would probably have been better for Vanderbilt to just knock the ball down. But it really didn't matter. That was the very next play where Ralph Webb scampered 75 yards. So it really wasn't that. But the interception wasn't bad. It was kind of what he's taught to do in that situation. You know, it's fourth down. If your option is to chuck it down, it's just as good as a punt. And in that situation, it actually was better. But, yeah, it's just going to it's gonna be nice to see where this offense goes from here. This kind of did struggle, you know, 2 games in a row from Georgia and Vanderbilt now. It's kind of weird that, you know, Harris's first start was at LSU. And that was the best start. And it seems somehow, I'm probably more tape, I'm assuming, but teams have kind of figured out and picked up what McElwain likes to do with Treon Harris, and defenses have really picked up on it. So it's really going to be nice to see, you know, they go back to the drawing board, like I said, maybe get the running game a little bit more involved. And like you said, they didn't run many plays at all. So like when they got behind on first down, that really hurt the offense. But like you said, and when you brought it up again, it was the turnovers that were the ultimate equalizer. Florida has taken care of the ball. They were plus 12 in turnover margin. But they were probably due for a game like this. And to come out with a win again just speaks to a lot about, you know, the players' resolve. And it came down to that all-important Austin Hardin field goal.
And that's a great point, because we tend to get into a game like this where one team's a substantial favorite. They struggle. They barely survive. They win it. And we focus on the negatives. But the positives are all over the place. And it's still competitive football against a Vandy team that is suddenly not the worst team in the SEC playing competitive football in recent weeks. And the Gators do come out on top. People, I'm sure Florida fans are out there connecting the dots. If they were watching football all day, they're saying, that's our offense at noon. And then at 8 o'clock at night, I'm watching the team that we're most likely going to play shut down Leonard Fournette to like 1.5 yards per carry. Wow. What are we going to do? But there's still a lot of football left to be played, starting with South Carolina this week. You bring up the missed extra point. Nice little story with Neil McInnis on one hand, but the kid hasn't kicked since high school in 2011, so they have to go to Austin Hardin to kick the game-winning field goal with about 2 minutes and change left. So that can't make Gator fans feel real secure about needing a game-winning kick.
No, you're right. And McElwain kind of joke. McInnis, you know, he's a dental student. So McElwain even joked around after the game. He goes, anything inside 20, the dentist was going to kick it. Austin's, you know, Hardin field goal was a little bit longer than that, and that's why McElwain trotted him out. And, you know, many Gator fans were wondering, were they going to go for it on fourth down, or were they going to let Hardin kick it? And for all the flack Hardin has gotten, which is pretty well deserved, he also really deserves being in the clutch. It was last year. It's kind of similar to style of game, you know, and Florida was struggling against Tennessee in fourth quarter comeback, and Austin Hardin lines up for a 51-yard field goal. He had struggled a lot before that and nails it right down the middle. And Florida beats Tennessee 10-9. Kind of same situation here. Not a lot of confidence in him. McElwain trots him out right down the middle. So for all of, you know, Hardin's troubles, he really does kind of seem to come through in the clutch for the Gators in you know, his career's biggest kicks. But, yeah, it's still going to be an issue moving forward. And we knew there was going to be that game where the field goal kicking was probably going to come back to bite Florida. Earlier in the game, Florida went for a fake field goal. They did get the first down, but C.C. Jefferson did fumble before he hit the ground. Vanderbilt recovered. That was one of the turnovers. But it just lets you know the confidence wasn't quite there if McElwain really wanted to fake that field goal at that time.
I thought, David, when you said McElwain had a joke after the game, considering the field goal kicking and the kid who's a dental student, I thought it might be go along the lines of maybe our kicking game's about as painful as pulling teeth, something like that. I thought you might go in that direction. So we got South Carolina coming up, and obviously a substantial favorite on the road against the Gamecocks, but this team is playing much better football in recent weeks. Almost stole one against Tennessee. The week before, played very well, came within one score of Texas A&M. So this is not a gimme game, and it's not just Florida playing out the string to get to the SEC championship game.
Right. You know, since C. Spurrier announced his retirement, you know, South Carolina's kind of picked it up a little bit. Perry Orth, starting quarterback, you know, Ferrell Cooper, you know, he is what he is. We know what he is. But, yeah, they're up next. They played well against Tennessee. That was a game very late last drive. They had a chance to go in there and, you know, tie and win that game maybe. But it's going to be a good chance for the Florida offense to maybe try and get something going. You know, the South Carolina defense is still struggling stopping teams. It's going to be nice to see maybe if Treon Harris can get a little bit of rhythm, maybe get the passing game going and the running game, like I said, with Scarlett and Taylor going a little bit more. Also with the week after that with FAU before FSU, so there's, you know, two games against South Carolina and FAU where the defenses aren't, you know, what they should be, and where hopefully Florida can take advantage of some of the weaknesses there. But it's, you know, the Florida defense, you know, still strong, shouldn't have much of a problem against South Carolina. But, you know, it is a noon game. It is on the road. McElwain was kind of worried about the noon game last week. It was the first one of the season. Even this late in the season, kind of, you know, weird about that. But this is the first noon game, and this was on the road. So McElwain definitely said a while ago in his press conference he wants to see how this team responds again, and especially after an emotional close win. They have the East wrapped up. Like you said, they're on their way to Atlanta. Does this team already feel like it's accomplished something, or can they go on the road now and get another W and keep their playoff chances alive?
Yeah, it's kind of strange to talk about a team that's got three games left in the regular season that's wrapped up a division championship. So they've got a spot in the conference championship game. But this team, based on the conference it's in, based on what it's accomplished thus far, has maybe bigger fish to fry down the road. So you got to take care of business for the next 3 weeks and just say, we've won the division championship. We're good to go to Atlanta in 3 weeks. No, you got three football games. Two in particular could be very tough. Obviously, Florida State at the end, still won a very dangerous team, as they showed us against Clemson, and Florida in position to stand up against most likely Alabama in the SEC championship game with a spot for the Final Four in college football. All right, David Waters joining us from Florida Gator Sports Radio, breaking down Florida football. So it's always nice to catch up on the Gators. Thanks, David.
Thanks, Mark.